Thank you, Phyllis. Wonderful. Well, good morning, friends. Blessings to all of you in the name of the risen Lord. It is certainly a blessing to be here in this worship space. My name is Reverend Jeff Prothro, and I want to make a special welcome to any visiting guests who are joining us today, and welcome everyone who is joining us online as well. It is a blessing to be able to share in worship, not only here, but everywhere, because God is everywhere, and we'll be talking about that a little bit later on this morning. But before that, take a few moments, look at the back of the bulletin. We have announcements listed there. One special announcement I'm going to draw your attention to. It shouldn't affect you unless next week you are like, you know what, I want to get here early. Well, we're just having one service at 11 a.m., and it'll be a communion service that we'll probably see some of our friends from 9 a.m., and it'll just be a good old time as we head into the 4th of July celebration. So one service next weekend at 11 a.m. Well, friends, we conclude our sermon series on the Queens of Country with one of my favorite books of the Bible, Esther. And it is a story about kind of learning about your own power within to make real change in the world. And so it's going to be a wonderful message, I think, but the music is going to be even better as our wonderful worship team will be leading us into all sorts of bluegrass songs, and it's just a special time in worship. It's been a fun worship series to share with all of you, and I am especially grateful for all the talent that have lent their voices to this past month. Well, friends, let us continue this time of worship together. This morning I almost skipped the call to worship, but was brought back together through the power of Christ, amen. And you're invited to stand as you're able as Reverend Kim leads us in the call to worship as printed in the bulletin, and the words will be on the screen.
We gather to worship with expectations God revealed in new and astonishing ways. God comes to us in real time. God comes to us in dreams. Sometimes God's presence is hard to take in, difficult to believe. Oh God, we long to believe. Help our unbelief. God is present here. God is working in our midst. Then our mouth and filled with laughter, our tongues shout out with joy. As we sing together our opening songs, down to the river to pray, now thank we all our God.
As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, come on down, come on, sisters, let's go down, down to the river to pray. As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, come on down, come on, brothers, let's go down, down to the river to pray.
friends, before we welcome one another and say hello, I did fail to mention, this month we've had several volunteers in our nursery because our nursery care worker, Bet, on June 14th gave birth to twins. And so we welcome into the world Esri May and Nolan Anderson. And with that in your heart, let's welcome one another this morning.
So friends, Jen Tyler, one of the co-authors of the book Speaking Truth, says, "Too often, women have been silenced by the world around us. Today we stand together. We refuse to be silenced. We refuse to passively watch the world pass us by. As women, we are finding our voices and raising them like the women did that first resurrection day. Though the people around us have not been quick to listen or believe, we, like Mary, speak truth anyway, we lead anyway. When we pray, act, and speak together, we claim a new vision for how things can be. A vision that honors women before us like Phoebe, Prisca, Hagar, Ruth, Naomi, Esther, and the countless women who remain unnamed, both in scripture and in our modern world. We are raising our voices and telling our stories as women of faith. So, friends, let us center upon the power of the Holy Spirit who keeps inspiring us to act and speak for justice as we now pray the centering prayer with one voice. You will find the words in your bulletin and on the screen. Our gracious and ever-loving God, we come ready to experience your grace. We rest in the knowledge of the wonderful works you have done for us, and of the deep and abiding love you have for us and for all God's people. Search our hearts, fill our soul with your indwelling spirit, who whispers to our soul that all will be well if we but trust in you. Let us stand in the firmament when needed. Shine your light of justice and compassion before us, that we may see our path to you and to your kingdom on earth. Amen." Let's continue to pray in silence. Gracious God, we are forever grateful for the voice you have given us and the strength you have given to it. Help us learn when and how to use it so that your work might be accomplished and your love better shown upon this world. We pray in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite the children to come forward for our time. Well, welcome to you and your sister who's over there. I'm so glad you guys are here. So today's story, like Pastor Jeff's, is one of my favorite stories. I love the story of Esther. And so I want to start with our story, okay? I want you guys to listen and see who Esther listens to, okay? And how is Esther being brave?
So let me read from Esther chapter 4, verses 1 to 3 and 13 to 17. When Mordecai learned that a decree to destroy all the Jews had been issued, Mordecai tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes and went through the city, wailing with a loud and bitter cry. He went up to the entrance of the king's gate, for no one might enter the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. In every province, wherever the king's command and his decree came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting and weeping and lamenting, and most of them lay in sackcloth and ashes. Mordecai told Esther, "Do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this." Then Esther said in reply to Mordecai, "Go, gather all the Jews to be found in Susa, and hold a fast on my behalf, and neither eat nor drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will also fast as you do. After that, I will go to the king, though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." Mordecai then went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. Did you catch that funny name of the guy that she listened to? Mordecai, right? And so Esther was in a tough situation, wasn't she? You ever been in a difficult situation? Maybe not knowing what to do? Mm-hmm. That's kind of the situation that Esther found herself in. And Mordecai tells her, "You know what? You're in the palace. You're a queen. Go and talk to the king, even though it's against the law." Now, we don't have that privilege. I can't just walk into the White House and talk to the president because I want to. They won't let me in. I won't make it that far. Even though I'm a queen. We're all queens. Come on now. And so then Esther does it. And we don't get that part of the story, but she goes and she talks, and all the Jews are saved, and Esther is saved. But here's the thing, right? I wonder if Esther would have done that without Mordecai, without someone to encourage her, without having someone that she could go to and talk to about it. I bet you have people in your life you can talk to when it's difficult. Maybe your dad, maybe your mom, maybe Pastor Jeff, maybe anybody you meet at Sunday school, your teachers. Am I forgetting anybody? Me? Okay. Am I forgetting anybody else? Everyone. Everyone here, right? You could talk to anyone here if you had a problem. They would listen. They would help, right? And here's the other thing I want you to remember, okay? So there's a guy in this story that we didn't hear. His name's Haman. And I would say he's kind of a bully, but he's a bully that has some power, right? He could do the things that he wanted to see happen, right? And so I want you to remember that the habits you're building now will follow you as you get older. So if you think it's okay, and I don't think you think this, but if you think it's okay to pick on somebody or to see somebody get picked on when you get older, you're still going to think it's okay for people to bully other people and pick on other people and make people feel smaller. But if you start building a habit of telling someone, like some of those adults that we mentioned, you're always going to look for the help as you get older of how can you stop that? How can you help everybody be treated as someone who God created and God loves? Okay? Thanks for being here.
Okay, everyone. I know you want to just sit there politely and listen, but I encourage you to make some noise with us this morning. You can sing along with these pieces. Even if you don't know the words, you can sing along. You are also, I know, I'm looking at you, Ethan. And I also encourage, if you want, you can clap, you can stomp your feet. Brenna, do you want to show people what beat to clap on?
There you go.
2 and 4. Good. And I also just want to warn you, if you walk in here when we're practicing, I will give you an instrument to play. And so we welcome up Mark Stoneberger as our chuck-a-chuck guy. So sing along, have fun, make some noise, and enjoy yourselves this morning.
Some glad morning when life is on. Thank you.
worship team. And you all are always invited to come and join in the fun. It's a lot of fun. That's why I don't come in here until about 10:55. So amen to that. Well, friends, will you pray with me and for me? Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be a... Let me start over. Sometimes I get a little caught up in the moment. Friends, holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be a faithful response to the Spirit moving among us in this place, in this moment. Amen. Well, I really love stories about unlikely heroes or heroines. In fact, the past couple of weeks in our household, for some reason, I'm not sure why, I just started re-watching the Lord of the Rings trilogy. How many of you out there have seen it, have read the books? It's, you know, it's only 10 hours long or whatever. And so I thought, hey, I could watch this in half-hour increments. And you know what? It makes a pretty good television series. And I got to say, when I did watch it, as I was watching it, I found myself napping through all the battle scenes, you know, thinking, yeah, I've seen this a million times. And what I began to focus on, though, were those quieter moments of Frodo. Now, Frodo has been given a task. You know, he's a hobbit from the Shire, has been given the task. He's gotten access to this ring of power that was made by Lord Sauron that's been around for a couple of thousand years. And next thing you know, Frodo is having to go on this adventure to go into the heart of Mount Doom to get rid of it so that the whole world will not be taken over by the evil forces of Lord Sauron. And yes, when I say that aloud, I know it sounds ridiculous, but it really is a good story. Because when you break out all the little elements, it becomes kind of this classic story of a person who's under extraordinary circumstances having to make certain choices to ensure that the betterment of the world can prevail. And so that's what I had a tendency to focus on with this last viewing. It was like, wow, Frodo at the end is given a choice and has a choice. And how does Frodo respond? Luckily, there's some outside factors that help in the destruction of this ring, and Frodo and his faithful companion Samwise Gamgee are able to overcome evil eventually, but it's not without a lot of peril and a lot of having to step out of Frodo's self in order to deliver the ring to Mount Doom. Now, I gotta be honest, you don't need to spend 10 hours to watch Lord of the Rings. If you don't want, I mean, I recommend it. Or you don't need to take time to read the book, though the book itself is really good. And I promise, if you came up to me and said, Jeff, can we watch Lord of the Rings together? I will not quote the movie while watching. I'll just let you watch and enjoy. But within the biblical text, there is a great story about someone who has to make a choice about whether or not to use her own power to ensure that the greater good will prevail. Because a few months ago, in our Monday morning Bible study, we decided to read this little book, the Book of Esther. Now, it was written a few thousand years before The Lord of the Rings, and itself reads like a classic story of palace intrigue and good versus evil, where people have to make hard choices. Instead of 1,000 pages, it happens in 9 chapters. Now, it doesn't have a full-blown adventure, no one goes on a big quest, but deals with similar issues of power and the choices we make. And what do we do when we find ourselves in certain circumstances in life? Will we make the right choice? The title character herself, Esther, a lot like Frodo, is of humble origins and is thrust into the spotlight, finding herself having to decide whether to keep quiet about her true self to save her own skin, Or is she willing to risk letting others know and be bold in her queendom to the point of risking death to save the lives of many others? That's really at the heart of the story. Now, the quick PG version of the book of Esther is fairly simple. The Jewish people are living in exile in Persia under the rule of one Xerxes. Now, Xerxes is a bit compulsive. He's the rash type. And it opens up with him immediately banishing his wife, Vashti, from the kingdom because she refuses to do his bidding. And at this refusal, Xerxes, like, you know, maybe some other politicians we may know about, says, get out of here with you. Vashti happily says, okay, I'm gone. But then after her banishment, the king decides to have a huge royal beauty pageant. Again, this is the PG version. And an orphaned Jewish girl named Esther wins and becomes queen. And we cheer for Esther. We're excited for her. Now, Xerxes, though, had a henchman. Now, when I say this name, you all have to hiss. This is what you do in the story. The henchman's name was Haman. That good job. And Haman gets really angry at Esther's cousin Mordecai because Mordecai, you know, refuses to bow down to Haman. I mean, just think the gall of this person. Haman's like, you need to bow down to me. Mordecai says, the heck with you, I'm not going to do this. And so Haman goes to Xerxes and says, hey, these Jewish people need to be getting rid of in the worst possible way. So Xerxes, you know what you should do? You should make a decree and make it so. Xerxes probably takes 2 seconds, is like, okay, whatever, I'll make this decree. I'll keep Haman happy. And says, why not? But what Xerxes doesn't know is that his new queen, Esther, herself, is Jewish. But you know what? Once you say something and make it so, you have to make it so. And so we arrive at this scene in our scripture. This moment of reckoning as Mordecai finds out about the decree and figures out, wait a minute, I need to appeal to Esther. And it's kind of, it's through various people, through various couriers, to use her new power and position to change the king's mind. But it takes a little bit of convincing for Esther to actually take action. You know, there's some parts of scripture I left out in the reading this morning, but we do know that the tension is rising. And the question will become, what will Esther do? You know, she probably gotten a little comfortable in her role as queen. And she also is like, I'm not sure if I'm ready to step into this situation. I don't even know if I have any power to do anything. And then as Esther is working through this question, we kind of ask ourselves, wow, if we found ourselves in this same situation, what would we do? How would we respond? Esther, in this moment, finds herself at a crossroads. Now, one can imagine Esther's inner monologue as she weighs her options in a difficult situation. What can she do? She's just one person from a humble background who got lucky in becoming the queen. Even though, you know, as you kind of read through the story, the king really doesn't even bother to acknowledge her except when it's convenient. But if she reveals that she's Jewish, she'll likely get killed. But it's because of her Jewishness that she could save her people. And then there's this other weird decree that Xerxes has made that says that, you know what, unless the king summons you, if you go to see the king, you'll probably be killed. And so, you know, here we have Esther really caught in the middle. We have a rock here, we have a hard place there, and we have Esther. What can she do? And so this dilemma points to a dynamic we are all confronted with at times as people of faith. So many of us, in so many different ways, are doing what we can with what we have to living a life that is reflective of the gospel, of being loving in our relationships, helping those we can, demonstrating compassion in our journey. But ultimately, sometimes we ask ourselves, do we really have any power to make a difference in a sometimes difficult world? What risks are we willing to take for those who live on the margins of things and need refuge? Where does our own self-identity lie? Are we Christians first? Do we just simply see ourselves as American? Are we parents? Are we siblings? Are we just employees? What can we really do? And so this story sheds light even on our current lives. Esther must experience growth in trusting that all of who she is matters, of being Jewish, a queen, a woman, in informing the best way forward for her. But of course, that doesn't mean there isn't doubt or second guessing. It's perfectly natural for us to deal with self-doubt. In neglecting to lean into who we are as Christians in a cultural setting that's sometimes dominated by a me-first mentality and continual political brinkmanship, what can we do to actually bring about change? What are we willing to risk? Or are we satisfied with the status quo of things? If that satisfaction means our own lives won't be disrupted too much. And so we get this little nudge. Sometimes we need a little nudge. Mordecai in the story provides a little nudge. You hiss Haman, not Mordecai. And so Mordecai offered these words to Esther, that she perhaps were put into a position for such a time as this, to bring about the real and needed change. Now, I think about, if this were a movie and I were watching this on the big screen, when Mordecai says that, hey, for such a time as this were you brought here, that would probably be the line we'd all be quoting after the movie. Wow, any one of us are ready for such a time as this. We too are always standing in that place for such a time as this, where we who are on a personal level can affect the wider world we inhabit. Because we love these stories about people who make those impossible choices and do what's right. And so Esther responds that she'll take the risk. I can imagine, again, that when this scene unfolds, that when Esther says, you know what, I will do it, and if I perish, I perish, that there'll just be shouts of, yes, queen, and excitement. Look, Esther is making the right choice, and we celebrate her stance and aspire to do likewise, because this is a story of aspiration for all of us. And so it's interesting. One of the noticeable characteristics of the book of Esther is its lack of reference to God. Nowhere in the story does anybody mention God, whether in prayer or to seek help from the Almighty. That absence speaks to a bigger truth about God. Yes, God is present in our lives. We, though, guided by grace, must make the choice to be actively engaged the best we can, ready to use our power, real or perceived, to bring about the desired outcomes, or we can choose to remain passive in our approach, hoping others will get the work done. Either way, whether we say so or not, God is still present. God is allowing us to respond to that grace and take initiative. Esther must decide and grow into understanding that she does have an inward strength and outward access to bringing about change. Because we all have within ourselves the capacity to take what God has given through grace and affect the world around us. This morning, a lot of us listened to local leaders from Mom Demand Actions for Gun Sense speak of their journey of creating space to discuss how we can effectively protect others from gun violence. It was an organization founded in the wake of Sandy Hook over 10 years ago that seeks to work with lawmakers and community groups to help alleviate gun loopholes, educate on gun safety, and foster an environment of needed conversation that cuts across the political divide. These are ordinary people sensing a change needs to happen. Sometimes that means going against the grain of things and seeking to do what's right and not popular. But the question kind of came up is like, well, what can you do in an environment in which you don't think any change can happen? But one thing that rang true was the fact that one of the leaders said, you know what, if we can effectively help one household, one family, one person not be affected by gun violence, even through something as simple as a gun safe or just a trigger lock, then we have brought about real change. And that builds. One life saved can build to many other lives that are saved. Now, a few weeks ago, the focus of our VBS was Hero Hotline. And we shared stories of the Bible of people working together, just like we had all sorts of volunteers who are working together, showing these kids were loved and deserved a beloved community to grow up in. And one of the things about these stories and sharing in these stories and sharing in this story of Esther is it truly does plant seeds that will lead to a spark later in life. So that those children who went to VBS, I remember my VBS experience when I was a child, that perhaps in a moment, any one of those children are caught in a time where they with confidence can show God's justice and mercy at work. And that's because we created that space for that to happen, for those seeds to be planted. And it's through your work and so many of the volunteers that simply showed that these children were loved, that they were seen by God, and empowered to make choice and to reflect upon where is God's love at work. All of this because of who we are as a congregation, who you are as ones reflecting these queens of country that we've explored this past month. Now, I realized this morning I forgot to tell the rest of the story of Esther. I forgot to say what happened to Haman. There you go. And that ultimately, the Jewish people were saved. Truth and goodness and love is what ends the story of Esther. And so it demonstrates for us that a few simple actions by someone who initially probably didn't have the confidence needed turn into something great for a whole people. And each and every one of us have within ourselves things both big and small to demonstrate that very love. I do believe God is continually preparing us to step forward to speak truth to power, even if we're not fully aware of it. Sometimes just our presence demonstrates something very powerful. We are all on this journey leading to those moments of standing in places for such a time as this. We are part of God's story of having our faith fueled by the Spirit, giving us the courage to take necessary risks wherever we live, wherever we go to school, wherever we work. We also collectively have the power to continue to be a vital presence in the community because that power truly is us, the church with all its gifts and graces doing God's work. We are like Esther, willing to go into those difficult spaces of fear and castigation to speak a word of light and truth, and ready to shout out, "Yass, Queen," on the other side. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, we are blessed by these stories of faith. We are blessed by the women of faith, by Queen Esther, who grew into self-confidence and courage, recognizing that you were always present in her life and their lives, just as you are present in our lives as we seek to grow as disciples together. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Offering is a time for us to be a reflection of God's grace, to be a reflection of that very love that demonstrates compassion in the world. And our offering is the totality of who we are as disciples here at Asbury, ones who are present to each other through our prayers, through our presence, through our gifts, our service, and our witness. The ushers will come forward at this time so that we can receive the offering.
I went up to the mountain because you asked me to. Over the clouds. sooner or later, it's there I will go.
On this lovely day at the end of the month of June, we praise and thank you, O Lord. We bring before you our gifts, our lives, and our talents. Take all these gifts and use them for work in your kingdom. Amen. Now let's sing together our closing song, God of the Women, to the tune of Be Thou My Vision.
Friends, may you go from this place refreshed and renewed in the Spirit. knowing that you've been empowered by God's love to demonstrate the fullness of Christ's love for everyone. Go now in peace. Amen.